And so there's all these areas of the brain where there's not enough opioid receptors. And my thought is, I think the brain is trying to goose the dopamine neurons. The brain is going, go, go, go. And the dopamine neurons are asleep. So two chemicals that turn on the dopamine neurons, endorphins, or hydrocodone, morphine, heroin, that's one chemical. You make that stuff, it's called endorphins, and the fibromyalgia patient's making a lot of it. The other chemical that turns on the dopamine neurons and makes them go, it's a trigger, it's called substance P. Substance P is an activator of dopamine neurons. And if you draw the spinal fluid out of a fibromyalgia patient, they make lots of substance P. And so my thought is that that brain center is asleep, and the brain is doing all it can to wake them up, and it's making too much of these other chemicals. That's my thought. So anyway, these are just a series of pictures that show where these mu opioid receptors are all not working correctly. Not surprisingly, areas of the brain control cognition, mood, pain response, stress response. And this is an area, finally, that I have developed an interest in. How many of you are aware that there may or may not be a problem with cervical anatomy in some patients with fibromyalgia? How many of you heard anything about the neck in fibromyalgia? So a minority of you. This is a very controversial area for several reasons. Every nerve in your body besides the one that innervates your head go through your neck. It's kind of a bundle that collects all the nerves. So if you had a problem in your neck, it would theoretically affect every part of your body. So there was a group of researchers in Chicago and a gentleman that was originally in Alabama, now in North Carolina, who published some papers where they said, well, you know, these people had neck problems, and they were sent to the clinic, and they said they had fibromyalgia, and we're surgeons, and we don't care about fibromyalgia or not, but they were in a lot of pain. But they sure as heck had neck problems, and we opened them up and fixed that and put them back together, and lo and behold, their fibromyalgia's gone away. So, wow, a surgical problem that you can fix to fix your fibromyalgia, yes or no? Well, that's a battleground. That's literally a battleground in research. You can get into arguments. And Andy Holman, who's my partner right now in crime, we originally were the ones who developed the whole interest in dopamine. And so I thought, you know, Andy wrote to me and we were big friends. And then I went to this conference and he was sitting with those people. And he seemed to be having a good time. And he was nodding his head yes when they were speaking. I was like, what the heck? So I went up to him, I said, I really hurt his feelings. I said, Andy, you've gone over to the dark side. And I really hurt his feelings, as I found out later. He said, you know, Patrick, I'm just listening to what my patients are saying. And that really hit me, because I just told you, everything I learned from patients, right? So I was like, well, what are they telling you? And I listened, and then I wound up in Seattle, Renton, actually, working in his space, and I started seeing those patients that had been diagnosed with neck problems, and I started getting these MRIs, And so this is what we've come up with. Intermittent cord compression. That means if you're just sitting there in the chair, you don't have a problem, but you look up at the ceiling, or you bend over like this and you're looking at your computer, or you're swimming, or playing pool, you're doing something, you know, getting your hair done, you're sitting in a dentist chair, and you wake up and you think, oh my God, what just happened to me? Somebody hit me with a truck. Intermittent cord compression was found in 65% of the patients that he sampled in his clinic. Not sure what it means to fibromyalgia, becoming more clear, and I'm going to show you pictures of that. Research being done at this time. This is what we do. So we take three pictures in a fMRI or an MRI scanner, and when you put your neck back, it makes that space tighter. Well, if it's tight to begin with and then you tighten it up a little bit more, you're going to mechanically compress that cord. And if you do that to a lab animal, they go wild. They develop pain problems. Their autonomic nervous system gets all out of whack. And so we thought, well, if you're doing this to a human, you know, what's going to happen? So there you see in that one picture in the middle on the bottom, looks like they're their cord has got pinchers coming out, and that's what's happening. The discs are soft. They might have benign joint hypermobility syndrome or something like that. The discs are soft. When they extend their neck, they crush their spinal cord. Well, after a year in the clinic, as I said this morning, I said, Andy, you'd gone over the dark side. Well, now the story with me is, Luke, I am your father. I'm well in. I fully believe that there's a neck issue in fibromyalgia. So what I'm interested in is cognition. I think fibrofog is this very interesting thing, and that's kind of been my research interest. And I've always thought, well, why don't we just call this ADHD? So what we did was we used a scale called the ASRS, the Adult ADHD Symptom Reporting Scale. It's 6 questions, scale of 1 to 6, how bad are these things in your life? And it's a 0 to 24-point scale. And we had, and this is an N of 50, we've now replicated with an N of 100. That means 100 people with a neck problem and 100 people without a neck problem. And we did the ASRS score. On the bottom, you see it's 0 to 24. Anything above 11 is a red flag for attention deficit disorder. And if you get above 18, you probably have attention deficit disorder. So when you look at the prevalence data, people with and without a neck issue, 30% of them, you would say, yeah, they probably have ADHD. The problem with ADHD is you have to have symptoms in childhood, and there's actually an abstract out that they asked a bunch of people with ADHD and fibromyalgia, did you have problems as a child? And most of them didn't. So something happens in adulthood that looks and smells like ADHD, but a psychiatrist would say no because you didn't have childhood symptoms. Well, dopamine depends on iron. So your brain's ability to make dopamine is linked to how much iron there is in your body. And now that I'm a poor little clinical physician out in the community and not a big shot university professor, I don't have a $10 bazillion camera anymore, but I got blood tests. So we drew iron levels on everybody, and there's a storage form of iron called ferritin. And so I said, well, attention deficit disorder is supposed to be a dopamine problem. Ferritin is an iron. Is there a crossover? Are you, you know, how would your thinking figure into how much iron you have in your body? Well, as it turns out, people who have lots of iron don't have any fibrofog, and people who have very little iron have a lot of fibrofog. If they don't have a problem with their neck. So 18% of your problems with fibrofog depend on iron if you don't have a problem with your neck. What about people who have a neck problem? All bets are off. There's cognitive problems associated with somebody crushing your spinal cord several times a day that have nothing to do with iron or dopamine or anything. So what does that mean? Are there two fibromyalgias? One in which iron matters and one in which iron doesn't. Well, we've demonstrated this forcefully. We're going to present this in Atlanta this fall at the ACR, the Rheumatology Conference. My thought is there's probably several things that we call fibromyalgia. And as I said this morning to the healthcare providers, saying you have fibromyalgia is like saying you have a fever. It tells you there's a problem. It doesn't give you any information about what the problem might be. And if I treated every fever that came into the clinic with Tylenol, I'd have a lot of dead patients on my hands. And if I treated every fibromyalgia patient with the exact same drug, there'd be a lot of people hurting. So I think the way to successfully treat the fever that is fibromyalgia is to figure out what's driving it. So apparently there's a problem with the neck that drives fibromyalgia. Other people, there's not a problem, and their stress response system's all out of whack. And you change that with blood pressure medicines, who would thought it? And their pain goes away. And sometimes it's their hormones, and they've got a lot of PMS, you know, you don't want to be around them. And you change that, and the symptoms get better. And some people go through menopause, and then their pain goes up. Some people have a thyroid problem. Some people are exposed to a statin drug. Some people get a car wreck. Some people had lousy parents. Each one of those things produces something that looks like hurts all over all the time, leave me alone. And I think that the chemistry is different for each one of those things, and the art of treating you is to listen to you, tell your story, and figure out what the elements of that story, be a good English major, do a little narrative criticism and say, oh, you said that, I'll write for this. The good news is, this is a study from IBS. This was a young lady who had been sexually abused in childhood, was in a bad relationship. She had IBS, horrible symptoms. They took a picture of her brain. It was just lighting up all over the place. She went through clinical recovery, got out of the bad situation she was in, was talked down out of some problems. Her brain changed the way it functioned. The pain went away, and they could take pictures of it. That's really cool. This has now been done with fibromyalgia. Amitriptyline, little generic drug that everybody gets put on. Of course, you wake up the next morning and you're a fat zombie. But that said, some people do really well on it, don't have those side effects. But it changes the way the brain works, and the changes are relative to your clinical improvement. This is my friend Bryant Wallet out in Washington, D.C. And what he did is a whole life thing. Took you off all your meds, put you in aerobic exercise, et cetera, et cetera. Probably didn't have chronic fatigue patients in the population, but they're all pure fibromyalgia. They did well with the exercise regimen, a little talk therapy. And guess what? Their brains changed the way they work in a way that made sense in terms of pain. So the story is there to be told in the brain. So some things I want to leave you with, and I'd like to answer some questions. We need to hear from a patient advocacy lady, Jan. Research advances continue to demonstrate the reality of fibromyalgia. If some clinician says, I don't believe in fibromyalgia, it doesn't exist, you have my permission to laugh in their face. And by all means, get yourself a different doctor. As we continue to make these advances and we figure out chemically what's going on upstairs and what causes it, we'll get better and better and better at treating this beast. And the thought I would like to leave you with, which is my faith, future's bright.